Hey everyone, welcome to the Bruce Williams channel. I am joined by my friend Robert here, who's actually, he's been on my channel previously. I've talked with you about your collection a little bit, and been a friend of mine for a long time, and you've been involved with something that is unlike anything I've ever heard about over the past couple years, and I wanted to talk to you about it and have you introduce basically a custom high horology piece that you and some other watch enthusiasts got together to have produced and have made. So that being said, welcome, and let's talk about it. So I have a thing up here on the screen. This is the name of your brand. Can you introduce it here?
Yeah. So our brand, it's a group of us. There's technically 51 of us.
Okay.
But we kind of consider ourselves the lucky 50, or the I think it's been referred to as the magnificent 50 or something. It's a running joke in the group.
Gotcha.
But there's a couple, a man and a wife couple. So we kind of count them as one.
Okay.
So 50 of us, 51 of us got together. And it started out way back in 2020.
Mm-hmm.
Another channel, Watchartsci.
Yeah.
So Bill Sanders has had this channel going for a while, and during the lockdown, he decided that he would do these live streams like on an almost daily basis or something like that. And everybody's home, everybody's locked down across the world, and what are you going to do? Maybe watch some videos on YouTube.
Yeah.
And I was redoing some bathrooms in my house, and I started watching these live streams daily or whatever, however often he did it. And the idea, the genesis of the project was kind of formed at that point of, well, wait a second, the world is shut down, everybody's locked up. What would be the chances of going to a top producer, a top manufacturer,
yeah,
and have them take on a smaller project for a group?
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe we could get 10 people together and we could really develop a high horology watch for a less, you know, smaller cost.
Sure.
And so the idea kind of started to gain steam a little bit on these live streams. And the only means of communication that we've mostly done throughout this entire process is through YouTube or WhatsApp and just chats and different things.
Uh-huh.
We haven't really done Zoom or anything like that. And so we just started going through. And the original idea was for a retrograde GMT jump hour. It had a variety of things going on. And then we started getting some of the projected costs,
yeah,
of what this would cost.
Sure.
And then other issues, obviously with COVID, came in, and some of the manufacturers that we had approached were like, look, we kind of really like this idea, but it's just not feasible.
Yeah.
You know, our workers aren't here, or if they're here, it's in a very limited capacity, and our suppliers are, you know, in the wind half the time, and we can't get a hold of them.
Yeah.
So it was decided, let's shelve this till 2021 and then restart it again, but perhaps start at a more basic time only, you know, because
you had a big idea.
Yes.
And then, all right, let's make it more realistic and doable.
Right. For the first project. Right. Because this was our first project, and it was like, well, why not just tackle a time only watch, not even a date function, because part of the concept was a bespoke movement. That was where we wanted to really start, was with the movement. I mean, given that this was a bunch of watch enthusiasts, we decided let's focus on the movement, and then we'll kind of go out from there and out from there. And so we kind of scaled it down to a time-only watch, and we approached Aiguille. Oh, the concept, first of all, for the group was, again, the best of the best of the best, and put it all together. We didn't know how we were going to put it together, but we were going to put it together.
Sure.
And with these best parts. So we approached Aiguille, and we basically pitched the idea of, hey, is there any way that you would be willing to take on this kind of a project?
Yeah.
You know, a lot of us have been really, really big fans of your work for many years. And if you really get into the weeds of some of the things that they've done, they have been involved in some of the most amazing projects in horology, I would say, in the last 20 years.
Yeah.
I mean, and you can go even obscure things where they've done modules for Romain Jerome and spacecraft watches and different things that you wouldn't even know they're involved. And they were the ones that attached their module on top of an ETA movement.
Yeah.
So we started talking with them, and they kind of liked the idea, and then it started gaining some steam, and next thing you know, we've got them on board. And then it was like, okay, well, we want Kari Voutenlanden's case company, Voutenlanden and Caton, as our case company. So approached them, kind of explained the process. Hey, we've talked to Agenor. We've got them on this side, you know. And so they started getting a little interested. But they were like, okay, well, we've got some hesitation. We're not just going to give you one of Kari's designs. You're going to have to, you know, come up with an idea. Now, in our inexperience of designing a watch, we just assumed we would come to these people and say, hey, we want a movement. Hey, we
give
want,
us a case.
Yeah,
give
we,
us
want, we want us a case. We want us a movement. Here you go. You know, just shooting off ideas and you then have them do the work for us.
So this was a big learning experience. Like, you had no idea the amount of effort and different things you'd have to delve into in order just to get a case maker and a dial maker and a movement maker and a designer. You got to hire this person. You got to do this and make it come together into something that 50 people, watch enthusiasts, can, I guess, come to consensus on, like, hey, I like this. I will put money down on this and let's make it happen. It sounds like this is one of those, I don't know, from my experience, once in a lifetime type of situations that come.
Oh, yeah.
Out. Like, I don't think something like this will ever happen again.
No.
It's kind of a miracle that this is being produced, right?
It is. It really is. We are spread across the world. I forget that. I always get it mixed up if there's 18 or 30 some odd countries. I mean, we are across the globe in multiple continents, multiple time zones, obviously.
Right.
And we have somehow managed, through Bill Sanders' YouTube channel, every week through WhatsApp and all these other things, manage these weekly meetings and kind of progress reports. And slowly but surely, and also much of the help has been done by our designer and our suppliers.
So tell me about the designer real quick. What's his name?
So I apologize. Matthew.
Sure.
Allegre. He has designed many other watches. He currently has three watches in the GPHG or the Watch Oscars for this year.
Yeah.
And that was one of the learning experiences that kind of caught us off guard. Again, going to these suppliers and having them say, well, okay, we're on board, but where's your CAD drawings and where's your technical specs and all these, like, we were just completely dumbfounded.
Yeah.
So we were advised by numerous people, hey, you should hire a designer. You need to have a designer. And so through Agenor, there was a connection there. We got in touch with Matthew, Matau, and basically he started the process. And we started getting these random shots of cars and upholstery and colors and just random idea board type things so that he could focus a little bit of the attention into a central point.
Gotcha.
We started this process with just the idea.
No expectations, really.
Yeah, we didn't even have technically anything written down on the napkin like you know, sometimes start as.
Yeah.
It was a picture of Philippe Dufour's Simplicity 37, and that was it. And that was where we kept going to these suppliers with this picture of a watch saying,
we want something like
we
this.
We want something like this, but we would never copy, you know, Mr. Dufour's work. So give us something different, but like this.
But something good.
Yes. Yeah, just like this, but different.
Yeah.
And so having Matteo like go through and like just start picking all of our random ideas and suggestions and try and find some cohesion. He then started to really hone it in, and he ended up
I look at this and you see a lot of curvaceous form. Obviously, it kind of looks like that Rolls-Royce, right? Was it a Bentley or Rolls-Royce?
So it was both. We started seeing Bentleys. We started seeing Rolls-Royce. We started seeing Art Deco buildings and different things that he was trying to pull in.
I can see that design inspiration. And then I can see the classic elements, you know, coming down to the Art Deco fonts and the kind of off-center subsidiary seconds, your railroad track. You've got classic elements, but it's different. Like, you put this next to, your inspiration watch, and you can see how it has some of the same qualities, even down to the signature there by the six, but it's completely different.
Correct.
And I think that's great because when you go into, let's say, a design, like I went to architecture school, I'm kind of that, you know, I liked art more than I liked mathematics and stuff like that.
Right.
That's just how I flew. But when you want something great, you don't try to force it. Like, okay, give us this exact watch, but just change a couple things. You let the process take you where it should be, where it should end up. And I think you guys have done that. Like, from my perspective, this has good cohesion. It has strength on its own. And I think it's going to look way better once you finally have it on wrist. And I can take some pictures
right.
here once you get it
right.
in hand. So I just want to commend you guys for letting the process take you where it needs to go and having, I don't know, not faith, but the positivity that it will arrive there. Because I can imagine from my perspective, trying to get on board with 50 other people and saying, no, you guys are dumb. We shouldn't have that font. We should have this, or we shouldn't have this handset. We should do that. And to have egos involved and agendas possibly, I mean, I know I'd want to like have my ideas actually take place, but it sounds like you guys really meshed well for the most part and
right.
you've arrived at something pretty cool.
It was fun. And you're right. There were egos and there were agendas, but we were also kind of instructed that the Swiss way is consensus. You know, very oftentimes it's through consensus that things are done over there. And that was another part of the learning process of the inner workings of these companies.
Right.
Right. There were some companies, I won't say, but we approached some of these companies and initially we were rebuffed.
Uh-huh.
Right, they didn't want or have any interest in a small group.
You're like a YouTube channel group, a Facebook
yeah,
group.
Yeah,
what is
like
this?
Like you want us to make a run of how many watches?
Yeah.
No, thank you, kind of a thing. And then it was like, okay, wait a second, you've got this supplier and this supplier. Oh, wait a second, this is actually.
Oh, you're
like,
working with so and so. Okay, yeah, let's talk some.
Right, this is actually a legitimate project. This isn't again some. Scribbled up thing on a notepad thing. Like this is a real project with real people and real money involved that are taking it serious.
Yeah. And well, sorry to interrupt. This was, you're entering this into the GPHG, correct?
Correct. This has been entered. It has been nominated. It has been entered and nominated. We are awaiting September 1st for the selection stage to see if it's a finalist. At that point, then the watch that we've entered will then go on a world tour and eventually go up for the, you know, basically the Petite Aiguille category, the little hand.
Okay.
And so it's basically the best watch under 10,000 Swiss francs. And it doesn't matter what, there's not really much more as far as qualification is concerned.
Gotcha.
Besides that.
Well, this is cool because you are not, like, there's no fat here. There's no brand saying, okay, we've got to pay our authorized distributors. We've got to buy it for this amount, and then they're going to mark it up this much. It's your work. You're paying a designer. You're paying a lawyer. You're, you know, paying the manufacturers, and you're not going to resell this. And so
no.
This watch, for what you're paying, I mean, you could easily, if this was one that you would be buying from an AD, right, I would imagine you're a lot more.
Correct.
Probably at least double
yeah.
what you guys are paying. So that's very, very unique.
Yeah, and I actually think that's what got us into some of these doors that we were initially rebuffed at, because mm-hmm. once they found out that there really wasn't a commercial interest involved,
yeah.
this was purely for the love of horology, and that was like, wait a second, that's different. You guys are spread across the globe and these random people, and you've come together during the lockdown to build a watch using the best parts solely to do that.
Yeah.
And you're not interested in making it a business. I think that's what got us in some of these doors.
I think you told me, because we've talked throughout the process a little bit.
Right.
I've found it fascinating since the beginning, but wasn't one of your manufacturers like, you know what, can I buy in on this? Like,
Yeah. So we have had some of our partners actually join the group. So if you look on the picture, and Bruce, you can, you know, inject a close-up of the case back, there's 70 watches. You heard me from the beginning, let's say 51, 50. Right? 51
yeah.
people, 50 of us. So we were each allotted two watches if we wanted.
Gotcha.
It was max number of 100, and not everybody did it. I only got the one. But once we got, I think we were in the low 60s or something like that, 61, 62, something like that. And some of our partners were like, you know what? This is actually really cool. Would you mind if we got involved? Like, for our own sake.
Uh-huh.
So the fact that we have the top watchmakers and the top producers in the world, not just a part of the group, but actually interested in the final product, was another like, okay, maybe we're actually doing something here.
Yeah.
Maybe this is actually coming together if these people that do it for a living and are the best of the best are interested.
So that's so cool. And I think this is interesting because a lot of watch enthusiasts, they want to be in the game somehow. Like, a lot of them will approach manufacturers in Southeast Asia. They'll pick out a case out of a book. They'll kind of build a watch from options that are readily available. Like, they'll make their own micro brand, so to speak. And this is a similar idea. Like, you want to help create something awesome, but it's not a micro brand. Like, this is legit. I would classify a high horology piece with the level of finish, the specific manufacturers you're working with, and nothing like this has ever been done. And again, I mentioned it, I don't think anything like this will ever happen again. So you have something truly unique, and I mean, it's super cool.
It's interesting also throughout the process how often Bill, I don't even know the real number of how many times people have contacted Bill.
Yeah.
He was kind of the de facto point of contact for a lot of this stuff for obvious reasons. But we have had numerous people reach out to the group through Bill and kind of get an idea of like, how did you do this?
Oh.
How did you, you know, and they are interested in now trying to replicate the process because word started to spread throughout the small community in Switzerland and kind of spread throughout the, you know, a little bit more and more and more people talking, you know.
So technically you could be a trendsetter, but again, my opinion is no one's going to do it like you guys have done it because it started during COVID and a lot of places weren't working. People weren't, you know, busy trying to keep up with what they were doing. So
I would love to see what other people come up with. Just for the sheer fact that, again, this was done out of the love of watches and horology. So if other people are going to do that, I'm more power to them. I would be shocked if this happens on a regular basis. I'm not saying it can't be replicated, but to have 51 people spread across the globe over a year long, 2 years process to end up at a finished product that I think works really well.
Yeah.
Is not going to be a common occurrence.
No, definitely not. So I'm looking forward to seeing this in person when you get it. I really hope you guys do well in the GPHG. I'd love for you to have an award winner on wrist.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah.
That would be awesome.
And I appreciate you taking some time to just kind of talk a little bit about the process and what it's been like and then what the watch has arrived at. It's been actually really cool. So thank you for taking the time to talk to me and share it here with my viewers. So
thanks for having me. It's been awesome. And definitely check out the GPHG. All of the nominated watches are great. It's a really tough category, and I'm really interested to see how our watch stacks up.
Definitely. All right, guys. See you in the next video.